course there is. If I say to all the players in Odense that if they come to Esbjerg, then they are on the national team, mm-hmm. then that would be a conflict. But the way I am as a person, that's not in my mindset at all. I would help all the others, and I help developing players in Odense, in Viborg, in Herning, Kastrup, with all our competitors in the Danish league. So I think the ones who get the less out of it is probably Esbjerg. Because when I do the tactics against the national players, and I know what their strong side is and what their bad side is, and then I try to help them with their weaknesses when they're in a national team and say, I know that you always go left, I know you always shoot in your left arm, so please stop that. And then they know that's the next time they meet Esbjerg. Mm-hmm. So maybe I pull the carpet away from myself, but still it's all about developing handball. And if Viborg gets better and Odense gets better, then Esbjerg also has to get better. So if they can raise the bar, we just have to follow. Mm-hmm. And I would like to help raising the bar for the Danish handball.
Hey Jesper.
Hi.
Who are you?
Oh, I'm the national women's coach of the Danish women's team, and also the head coach of Team Esbjerg, who's right now a part of the Champions League, and also the 2 times winner of the Danish Championship.
Congratulations. Where are we right now here?
We are right now after the last training before the match against Aarhus in the Danish league. We're right now only lost 1 point in the league, and so we're struggling a little bit with some injuries, and one player is pregnant and one player took the crossband. So we are a little low on players, but we're still in a good mood, and we still win matches and get some points.
Mm-hmm. It's a huge challenge this season, I could believe. Do you have any advices, or did you make anything different from the last season in this season? Because I could imagine that you need a very good load management for this season. So. Do you have any advices for that?
Yeah, it's very difficult because you have to build the road when you are driving, because nobody knows where the next day, what the next day will bring. And 2 months ago, everybody said that the Champions League probably wouldn't be played, and right now we are still playing and we are traveling around Europe. So if we didn't have the Champions League to play, then a small squad would have been the best. But right now, where we have a small squad and we still play Champions League, then it's a big challenge. So I think it's just about having common sense and then just settling about that it's a mess, and we don't know what the next day will bring. And then the most important thing for a coach and for a leader is that we don't bring the unstructured day down to the players. They just have to think about the handball and to do their best when they are on the court, and then it's up to us to find the structure.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Can you give us some insights? In a few days you travel to Metz, right? For the Champions League far away game. How many things changed? Did you drive earlier? Did you drive later to Metz? How are these any difference?
Yeah, the difference is that we have to be aware of the coronavirus. So we drive late, we try to take only one plane, we have our mask on from we start in Esbjerg to we land in Metz, and almost only take off the mask when we are playing the game and during training. So then we are still inside the hotel, and the same will be in the European Championship. It will be like a bubble, so we have to think about the players. They are isolated and they are not in prison, but the most strong thing to do about prisoners is to isolate them, and right now we're doing that to the players who love handball. So it's a tough situation for the players, and it will be even worse when it comes to the European Championship.
Did you see any difference to the game? Did anything change after Corona?
No, I don't think there's changed that much. The preseason was pretty different, especially here in Denmark. We were very aware about that we didn't overload the players. Mm-hmm. We knew that some of them have been away from the handball exercises for like 3 months, mm-hmm. and this means there was more injured players than normally, but even though that, we tried to take our advantage of it.
I saw in the last practice, not today, that you train with the boys together so they can play 6 against 6.
Yeah.
Is this a common thing here, or did you just do it because you have a small squad right now?
A little bit of both. If we have 16 players, like they have sometimes in Bucharest and Gjörp, then that would be maybe the best thing. But I like to train against the boys. I think the top of the under 16, under 17 is just about the level for a top level Danish league team in the women's. So I think it's a good preparation for us because they have a little bit more physics than we have, but they got the smart mindset yet because they are still young. So it's for us, we are normally in the top of the Danish league, where we have a little bit physical advantage over the other women's team, especially from the middle and lower. Then it's good for us to train the smartness, because we cannot win the one against one just on the physics, like we maybe can do against the lower level of the Danish league.
Mm-hmm. Let's talk a little bit about your insight into the Europe or a worldwide handball, because you are a coach of the Danish Handball Federation women's team, and also here in the Champions League. Did you see any differences between the Danish way of handball, maybe to the France way or to the Hungarian way of handball?
Yeah, there's a lot of difference, and also that's why that many of the players have problems settling when they come to Denmark. If you take the former Yugoslavian teams and the France players and the Spanish players, they have problems adapting to the Danish style and the Nordic style, because we play a lot with a lot more structure and with more systems. When we go south of Germany, then it's more like we play two against two, and then so there are a lot of difference and a lot of strength in both ways to play the handball. So when we get, for example, Sonja Fey from Austria, then I tell her that she should bring something about the one on one and two against two game that she is so good at, but she also have to adapt a little bit to the Nordic way of playing handball with more structures and more like we know where to go.
The collective way.
Yeah, you say it? More the collective way. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Can you describe a typical Danish coach?
I think, from my side at least, there's a lot of dialogue. Mm-hmm. If I look at the top national coaches and the top national coaches, especially in the club teams, then they are a little bit more structured, that they know what to do, and they don't ask the players that much. But I have a different way of thinking. I think there are so many talented and gifted players. So they have one feeling inside on the court, and I have another when I view it from the outside. So, and that doesn't always is the same way of seeing it. And why should I not listen to the? When I was a player, I expected my coach to listen a little bit to my advices. Mm-hmm. So now I have to do the same when I'm on the other side of the line.
Mm-hmm. Okay. You came from a huge player career. So you play, I read, more than 120 games for the national team, a lot of time in Skjern, in the highest league. How hard was the switch to be a coach?
I have a lot of thoughts in my mind before when I went from player to coach. Mm-hmm. And then I have to say that it was difficult, because it isn't always that easy just to go from one side to another side. I started with the women's team in Vejen, mm-hmm. and in the best league, and the first two or three months, I think I put so many informations inside the head of my players, I didn't know what was right and what was wrong. So I have to unsettle a little bit and do things different, and maybe be a little bit more conservative in my way of thinking. So if I have 100 thoughts in my head, the players will only know five of them now, because I can't expect that, because I have a lot of good ideas, that everybody can follow them. Mm-hmm. And many of my ideas is not good anyway, so it's pretty nice. I only take the top of the iceberg and show them.
Okay, I could imagine that you make the license then step by step here in the Danish system. Could you give us maybe three examples what was the most important thing you learn in this license here in the Danish
I think
coaching system?
Much of the thing I brought from the Danish coaching system was the alliance I get with the other coaches. Mm-hmm. There are so much knowledge in between every, and nobody's perfect. Mm-hmm. And that's the main thing about it, is that I have to learn from the other guys and I have to learn from the other coaches. So if you are open-minded, I think there's a lot of things to take out of it. And maybe not the not the school thing about the Danish coaching system, but the interaction there is between the coaches, and when you have a break and you just learn something about the defense in one side, and then you come out in a break and then you start talking about maybe we could do like this or this, and so I think there's a lot of interaction, and I think the interaction is also the way and the reason why I can call some of my colleagues and say I have a little problem with this, and I absolutely believe that they will help me if I ask them.
Mm-hmm. Okay, how was it to be, or how did you get the national position? Did you apply for it, or did the federation ask you? How was this way?
No, the last 3 years I've been here in Esbjerg, and we did pretty good on the court, and won some matches and won some titles. And then when Klaus Bruun, the former coach of the national women's team, he stopped, then I think there was the federation just talked about what kind of subjects it could be, and I was on the list, and they called me in, and I said that I really would like to keep on going with the club team in Esbjerg, and that was actually I would not say no to Esbjerg, because I think it's very important for a coach that if I was a national coach and came to the European Championship without having done anything handball the last 12 months, then I think I'll be a little bit out of touch, out of reach with when to take the time out, when to make the double substitution in defense, attack, and when should I change the goalkeeper. So it's important for me that I'm sharp and know what to do, and there's not room for big mistakes when you go to the national team.
So was there a lot of talks with the federation about it, or did you just have a clear structure and this was the offer?
No, there was a lot of talk about it, because the federation had a mindset that said that they thought that you should be full-time national coach. And I agreed that some of the points could be good, because then I had more time to go into the youth structure and how to develop Danish handball, and that would definitely be good. But still, the national federation also they are measured by the results to the European Championship and to the World Championship and to the Olympics. And if the result isn't good, then I can be the best coach ever to make the structure in the Danish Federation, but it's all depending on the results. And therefore I said to them, to get the best result, I have to be sharp. Mm-hmm. And sharp, that is when I'm on the court every day and training and making exercises and taking decisions and developing players. And I can bring the highest level. And I can bring that when I come to the national team.
Mm-hmm. Would you say that there are any conflicts between right now, because you work as a coach in the league, and a lot of your players from the federation plays in the league also, in Odense and Viborg and a lot of clubs. Did you think that is good, or did you think that is bad?
I think it's good the way I will handle it. There is a possible conflict, of course. Mm-hmm. There is. If I say to all the players in Odense that if they come to Esbjerg then they are on the national team, mm-hmm. then that would be a conflict. But the way I am as a person, that's not in my mindset at all. I would help all the others, and I help developing players in Odense, in Viborg, in Herning, Kastrup, with all our competitors in the Danish league. So I think the ones who get the less out of it is probably Esbjerg, because when I do the tactics against the national players, and I know what their strong side is and what their bad side is, and then I try to help them with their weaknesses when they're in a national team, and say, I know that you always go left, I know you always shoot in your left arm, so please stop that. And then they know that's the next time they meet Esbjerg. Mm-hmm. So maybe I pull the carpet away from myself, but still it's all about developing handball, and if Viborg gets better and Odense gets better, then Esbjerg also has to get better. So if they can raise the bar, we just have to follow. Mm-hmm. And I would like to help raising the bar for the Danish handball.
Yeah, this is my next question. How would you see the future of the Danish handball? Right now I saw a really good techniques. I see a lot of players play handball at a really huge level. Your league in both in women and men's teams are really good. How did you see the future of the Danish handball?
I think the Danish handball have been on a little bit of a downside over 15, 20 years now. We had a very good women's national team in the late 90s and the beginning of 2000. But then, I don't know if we missed to develop the world-class players. So when I look from outside inside to the Danish talent system, there was a little bit of a tendency that we had too many structured players. So as we talked about before with the Southern Europe way to play handball, one against one, two against two, and maybe more divas that they are more like, I want to be a star and I would like to say I'm a star. And in Denmark we have putting them into boxes and say, okay, this is structure, you have to behave good, you have to be good in physical training, you have to be good in running tests, you have to be good in school, you have to be good in everything. But if I look back on the time before when Denmark was on the top level in the national women's team, then it was Annie Andersen, she was unstructured, then Camilla Andersen, she was unstructured, and they did what they wanted to do, and they sometimes give a fuck in the coaches. And so, but these players are away from our talent system, and then we have to push them through. So we also get the little bit awkward people also. So I always say to my boss in the federation that I don't think that Estefan Pollmann would have come through the Danish talent system, and that's a problem. Would like to get Pollmann through.
I could believe that. What would you say exactly on these things,
talent selection? What things must change in a way, like? Back in Norway, they told me that they have the game and the youth teams are so fast, and when everyone is fast, they make easy goals, but the big guys, they're missing out.
Yeah.
So how is it here? Did you see that some players are not involved, like the extrovert players you talk about?
Yeah.
Are there any other player people you missed or that you like to develop with? Special coaching or selection?
Yeah, I miss very much that we're in our youth system. That's not only federation, that's even more in the youth clubs, that many of the coaches from the under 10 and up to under 16, they focus too much on the results. This means that they make systems and you can go like this. So you just like the running structure inside one attacking game is like, okay, that's the way we do it, and then we can make a goal. And that's good to make a goal when they use under 12. But still, that's not an experience you can use at all when you come to under 18 and even when you become a senior player, because you know where to run, but you cannot win one against one, you cannot pass the line play, you cannot. All the individual skills, they are lacking. But you know where to run, you can make an easy goal because the other team don't know what to do. But then under 18 or senior, you get tactics, and then the defense can just see in the video, okay, now they do this, they run over here, and they know, then the players don't know what to do.
What did you say is the most important thing for a talent here in Denmark? Which key facts?
Yeah, right. Until now, it has been to do all the structure. It has been to write a diary about how much I've been training and how good I am in school and how good I am in the structure. But in the future, I hope we also have these girls still. I say it's the A students. We have to get some D students also who don't like to go to school, but just loves handball, loves playing handball, loves. When I see many warm-up sessions in Denmark, I see stretching, mobility, and all this. And if they have put me to that when I was 12 years old, I would have started playing something else, because I needed the ball. I would like to play. I would like to have fun. I would like to be pushed in a playing way. Instead of just, okay, I can see on my numbers that I get stronger when I do my bench press and my squat things, and I can run longer, but Pollmann cannot do bench press for 100 kilos. Pollmann, she can play, and that's for me, she is the standard that we have to put inside the Danish talent system, both in the club but also in the federation. We have to get Pollmann through.
When we talk about the Danish coaching license, you say the biggest benefit for you was the exchange with other coaches.
Yeah.
Right now you go from these, I call it Danish level, to the international top level. In which field did you learn right now from coaches from other countries? So
I think I learned from other coaches by seeing them in the games. Mm-hmm. I see something else, and then, oh, that's pretty exciting what they do over there in the defense, in the offense, and then I still have to think about how can I, if I want to implement that in my way of playing, or show this to my players, and I also have to show them how to practice it, and not just believe that, okay, now instead of putting your feet like this in the defense, you have to put the feet the other way around. But I also have to make them think about it in the training and do some exercises. So that's pretty exciting. But I would still believe that I could call Emmanuel Mayonat in Metz and ask, what do you do when you want to do like this? And so I think there's a good dialogue between the coaches, and I have a good relationship to many of the guys out there.
When we compare the Danish way to other countries, would you say there are some, I would say, easy opponents and difficult opponents? So do you have more problems with the Spanish culture, or more problems with the Yugoslavian culture, or with the German?
Playing against them or integrated?
Against them.
Yeah, playing against them. Yeah, I think that the Balkan way, the former Yugoslavian way to play handball, is pretty hard for the Danish way to play, because they can put the speed up and down inside a match, and then they bounce a ball and then they walk up and take 1 minute to go to the attack, and then that's a big problem for the Nordic way to do the handball, because we would like just to run and run and run and run. So I think they sometimes outsmart us. Because we, if they break our structure, then it's hard for us.
Mm-hmm. You play, and now you're a coach for your whole life in Denmark. Would you say that you go abroad sometimes?
Not for sure.
Are you open for it, or did you have any?
Yeah, of course I'm open for it, but I don't have a dream about going to a foreign country to do it. Then it's more like to see the culture. But I'm also a family man, and I have 3 kids, and they like their daily life here in Denmark. So handball means a lot to me, but it's not everything.
Okay, one last question, or one last topic about the practice today. There was this special circumstance.
Yeah, I could go
to the goalkeeper, yeah. to the goal. How was it for you?
No, that's crazy, because we started the training by two keepers, and then one had a little bit of headache before we started, and I said, go home with you. And then 5 minutes later, there was the other keeper had a shot in her face, and so it was just like, okay, how much more can go wrong for us right now? So, but then it's fun, and I take 10 minutes in the goal, and sometimes I'm doing some defense, some attacking, that's okay. Then it's a way to keep myself sharp.
What were your thoughts about it? So how did you, because did you change the structure of your practice? So
yeah.
Did you do different topics?
A little bit. And still, there was 2 topics that I would like to, because we have a game tomorrow evening against Aarhus, and there was just one thing I would like to add to our game, because in circumstances that I see their defense against our offense, I think there were some possibilities about making a cross in one side and playing a block in the other. So that topic I had to go through. And then the rest of it is just to get a good feeling for the players towards the game tomorrow, and maybe have some of the... A big thing about my philosophy is that if I demand the players to go more outside in a game, then I also have to practice with them. I have to give them 50 or 100 routines about it the day before or 2 days before. So what I expect, I have to deliver myself. And the last 2 years, we've been using a lot of time in about playing outside for the wings, and this means that 40% of my training will also be to train outside the wings. So the backs get comfortable about that, solving the 2-against-1 outside, and that's also when I come to the national team, I can see that's not common for many of the other Danish mm-hmm. national players. So I also have to get that inside my training structure on the national team, even though we don't have so much time there. But of course, if we have a feeling that that's what you have to do, then we have to do it.
Awesome. Jesper, thank you. Mange tak.
Velbekomme.
Mange tak. And all the best for your season, and all the best for the long season with Corona and everything. I hope that Esbjerg and also the Danish women's national team in Norway will have a great success.
Hope so too. Thank you.
Mange tak.
Good luck with the project.